So we have a Ibiza right here. Very nice, very nice. It is manual. Very nice, very nice. It is also right steered. Very nice. And it's a pretty nice looking car. This is what's going to be driving me around for the next 3 days. I'll get a better shot in the morning, but for right now, this is what you get. Found the room. Now the trouble is finding the key, which I seem to always misplace because I'm an idiot and I'm just rambling to give you guys some good content. Very, very nice. Oh my gosh, where is the key at? I lost the key. Oh no. All right, there we go. Finally got it. It was in my back pocket all along. Now the door doesn't want to open. Oh no. Because it was the wrong way. Wow. Wow. J'ai oublié les pièces de résistance, les bains. Oh, c'est magnifique. Oh, je te trouverai. Oh.
You're walking along the British coast. And off in the distance, you see a ship that sails towards you. Off come a bunch of gentlemen that run after you and capture you. They end up transporting you back to Ireland and are forced to become a slave. After a while in slavery, you decide to go with Christianity and devote yourself to God. And you pray and pray, sometimes up to 100 times a day. And after a while, you get a vision. A voice calling out to you, telling you to go to the coast since there will be a ship waiting for you. And so you take the risk and you flee. Once you get to the shore, surprisingly enough, you see a ship off in the distance. Being able to get a ride back to British soil, you decide to devote yourself and study at a monastery for approximately 12 years. And during that time, you decide that your calling is to actually turn the pagans back in Ireland into Christianity. And when you're back in Ireland, you end up being successful in converting most pagans to Christianity. So much so that you end up building schools, monasteries, even churches all around Ireland. To the point even that you end up becoming the patron saint of Ireland. This would be the story of Saint Patrick of Ireland, who wouldn't be canonized in the 12th century, approximately 800 years after he passed away.
Para que todos lo sepan, yo se lo digo cantando. Estos versos que compuse para un hombre de Durango, Aurelio Sánchez Quintero, aquel del Bronco Fajeado. Cuando apenas era niño, su padre decía sonriente: si este muchacho se logra, va a ser gallito valiente. Ni
are currently in right now. Building has always been here since approximately the 11th century, and these are some representations of what they were like. But the one we are currently in right now has been here since the 1800s approximately. This one being 1172, that's a representation of what the castle looked back then, and this one in 1833, and that would be the castle which we are in right now currently. And from what I read, Handel, the classic music composer, actually hung around here a lot during his life. What the receptionist is telling me is that he's actually really into art and the antique of things. So most of this armor which we see around here is not authentic, unfortunately. Be a little red room in which they have in here. Very nice. Se encuentra, ¿verdad? Porque en 1014 había una batalla en cual vio perder aproximadamente 7000 a 10000 guerreros que participaron, ¿verdad? Y esa batalla en específica fue lo que independizó a Irlanda. This would be where the bar is. Fire door. And the great hall. Wow, can we turn anything on? Apparently not. I came up across something huge. When I was up that trail over there, there was a bunch of signs showing what was around, basically, right? So I read it, and look at these! It's a bunch of rocks! Wow! But the reason why these rocks are so special is that this is an actual tomb, right? A tomb from 2500 BC. 2500 BC being around 4,000 years ago. So this is pretty big on this island, apparently, and it's part of a golf course. Wow. So we are in Galway right now, and I just got to the Airbnb, that being the car. And right now, we're gonna go find some food, because I'm very hungry and I haven't eaten all day. But I saw a very nice looking casino off in the distance, in the little town right around the corner, so we should be Papa. This is Galway University. Wow, look at this. Miss Alice Perry, whoever knows that is. Mr. Michael M. Oscarczy, and some Ellie Anderson. Wow. One thing I've noticed whenever I'm in Europe or anywhere around these parts, right, is that there's always markets like these, always around the Christmas times, the Christmas season, and it's amazing. Everybody here in Ireland understands and speaks perfect English, but everybody here also speaks the original tongue, which is Gaelic. And talking to some people around here, introducing yourself would be Is Aname Antonio, and this would be the city view of Galway. And that was, where is it? I lost it. I thought it was, the Ferris wheel is right over there where I previously was. I don't even know where we are, to be honest. I should put it in the map. I'm in a little town. I see a church off in the distance. But this is where we're gonna be staying for the night. The Lodge B&B. B&B for breakfast. Bed and breakfast. All right, so we're currently heading to Guy's Bar, a bar I was recommended by the host. And it should be down this street, right around the corner actually. Yeah. I asked the guy to give me a beer, anything he chose, and he said anything local. I said, yeah, sure, whatever. Try it out. Wow.
pretty good, actually. Oh, shit. It's barely 6 p.m. Oh my gosh, and I'm already pretty messed up. But here is a castle behind me, a castle church. A church, not a castle, because castles have defensive measures around them. Churches are just churches. So there's a little fun fact for you guys. And guys, I really don't like beer. I promise you, I don't like beer. But whatever they served me over there at the guy's restaurant was super good, and I wasn't expecting that, honestly. But currently, right now, we're going back to the bread and breakfast, and I'm gonna take a nice long bath, and that's what's expecting me. So, good night, boys. It's been a pleasure, and I'll see you tomorrow.
Anoche desperté y a tu cuarto me acerqué, pues te quería ver, niña, por última vez. La muñeca que dormía junto a ti, ya no la miré, tampoco tu carita infantil. Me siento triste, voy a perder aquella niña que un día arrullé. Pero contento estoy también, porque mi nena va a ser mujer.
Airbnb right near the city center and around a whole bunch of apartment complexes, and
just to show you guys how close we are to the city center, the tram is right here and it's going to take us directly over there. So yeah. All right, so we're pulling up to Happy Street. This being the Loire, which I pulled up in, of course. And right in front of us, the anticipation is exciting me. Abbey Street. Wow. I saw something down here which caught my attention. It's a big pier. Look at that.
Schlatte, boys! Baby, we're
good morning, guys. So, last night was fucking hectic. Shout out to Mr. Darren, Mr. Mark, and all the people who were with us. I'm still pretty tipsy, if I'm being honest. I woke up tipsy, huh? Ain't that some shit? But right now, we're gonna go get some breakfast. We're gonna vibe out. I'm gonna go get some pain relievers, because enough said. Honestly, enough said. If I'm being honest, I wasn't expecting any of that yesterday. I said, I'm just gonna go to this bars. I'm just gonna vibe out and I get a beer, and then they sent me in this corner, right? It was just a table for one person. And I was looking at the live music, I started talking to people around me and everything, and these guys basically invited me to their table, and so we started drinking, and they kept ordering me more and more and more and more and more and more, and they wouldn't stop. And I said, nah, tonight, surely enough, I'm gonna black out. And so as the night progressed, I kept on conversating with these guys and everything, and it turns out they're a whole bunch of jockeys, and people who race horses, right? And I was telling them, hey, I actually used to practice with some horses myself. I used to be a charro, and I showed them pictures of Il Celso Quinceañera with the European horse they had and everything, and he was telling me, well, I actually manage horses. I manage some horses that are valued up to $200,000. And I said, wow. And he ended up offering me a job before the night ended. And the thing I was meaning to mention is that I tend to get paranoid when I'm drunk. Some other guy came out of the bar at the same time as I did. And I said to myself, no, this guy's going to rob me. This guy's, I just need to accept the fact that tonight I'm going to get robbed. And so I kept looking behind me for the longest time, and once I went over the bridge, I didn't see him anymore, right? But I was still under the assumption that he was like right behind me, and so I walked even faster. I was stumbling like crazy, and before I was about to get on the Luar, the train that takes me back to the apartment, I saw a lady. And she was right next to me, and I told her, hey, is it possible for you to keep an eye on me while I get off the tram? Because I'm pretty sure somebody's following me, and I don't want to get robbed. And the last thing I was meaning to mention is that I was talking to the guy right next to me, and I told him, hey, you know, a lot of people from where I'm from consider this the real Irish experience. And he looks at me and said, a real Irish experience would be going to a pub, getting drunk off your ass, and then fighting somebody by the end of the night. And I said, well, damn.
So I'm here on O'Connell Street in the center of Dublin. And what I came to realize, hello, is that here in the center is where Easter Rising happened. And we actually have some historical reference, which is right on top of this statue. On the left side of this statue, the chest that is, there is a bullet hole. And that happened because, everything that happened here. And the people who led the uprising against the British were captured and then were killed. But they were considered martyrs towards the events that happened later on, that such as the Troubles is what they call it here. And I was talking to some old guy on the bus so he can give me a better view, a better understanding of these situations. And he was telling me that Ireland has always been a Catholic country, but when the British came over, they tried to force the Protestant culture on everybody here in Ireland. So what the guy was telling me on the bus is that British intervention caused everything here in Dublin to be basically non-sustainable. People were making like 30 euros a week, from what I understood, and were barely able to live on that, and people just got pissed off over time. It got to the extreme of things that public Catholic gatherings and events likewise were actually made illegal throughout the country. Up here, very nice. Let's go touch it. Congratulations, I'm